Random House Audiobooks presents E is for Evidence by Sue Grafton. Read for you by Judy Kaye.
E is for Evidence. It was Monday, December 27th, and I was sitting in my office trying to get a fix on the mood I was in, which was bad, 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 comprised of equal parts irritation and uneasiness. The irritation was generated by a bank notice I just received, one of those windowed numbers with a yellow carbon showing through. At first, I assumed I was overdrawn, but what I pulled out was a slip dated Friday, December 24th, showing a $5,000 deposit to my checking account. What the hell is this? I said. The account number was correct, but the deposit wasn't mine. In my experience, banks are the least helpful institutions on Earth, and the notion of having to stop what I was doing to straighten out an error was nearly more than I could bear. I tossed the notice aside, trying to reclaim my concentration. I was getting ready to write up the preliminary report on an insurance case I'd been asked to look into, and Darcy, the secretary at California Fidelity, had just buzzed to say that Mac wanted the file on his desk right away. Mentally, I'd come up with a tart suggestion about what she could do with herself, but I kept my mouth shut, showing, I thought, admirable restraint. I turned back to my portable Smith Corona, inserting the proper form for a property insurance loss register. My nimble fingers were poised to type while I reviewed my notes. That's where I was stuck. Something was off with the insurance claim, and I couldn't figure out what it was. I glanced at the bank notice again. Almost with an eye toward the comic relief, I called the bank, hoping the diversion would help me focus on what was bothering me about the claim situation at Wood Warren, a local company manufacturing hydrogen furnaces for industrial use. They'd had a fire out there on December 19th that had destroyed a warehouse. I called the bank and spoke to Mrs. Brunswick. She assured me that a $5,000 cash deposit had been made to my account last Friday through a night deposit box. I told her there must be a mistake. She took my telephone number and said she'd get back to me. I could tell I was in for countless phone calls before the correction could be made. I went back to the task at hand, wishing I felt more enlightened than I did. My mind just kept jumping around. The file on the fire claim at Wood Warren had actually come into my hands 4 days before, late Thursday, the 23rd. I remembered that day. I'd been scheduled to have a farewell drink with my landlord, Henry Pitts, at 4, and then take him out to the airport and put him on a plane. He was flying back to Michigan to spend the holidays with his family, some of whom are edging into their 90s. Henry's pushing 81, a mere kid. I was still at the office that afternoon before Christmas, with my paperwork caught up and some time to kill. I went out onto my second-floor balcony, peering off to my right at the V of Pacific Ocean visible at the foot of State Street 10 blocks down. This is Santa Teresa, California, 95 miles north of Los Angeles. Winter here is a grand affair, full of sunshine and mild temperatures, vibrant magenta bougainvillea, gentle winds, and palm trees waving fronds at the seagulls as they wheel overhead. The only sign of Christmas 2 days away were the garlands of tinsel strung along the main streets. My name's Kinsey Millhone. Anyone who knows me will tell you that I cherish my unmarried state. I'm 32, twice divorced, no kids, and no close family ties. My parents were killed in a car crash when I was 5, and I was raised by my maiden aunt, learning self-sufficiency, which loomed large with her. I'm a private detective by trade. Usually I'm perfectly content to do what I do. There are times when I work long hours on a case, and times when I'm on the road, and times when I hole up in my tiny apartment and read books for days. When the holidays come around, however, I find that I have to exercise a certain cunning, lest the absence of loved ones generate unruly depression. Now Henry was leaving town, and even Rosie, who runs the dingy neighborhood tavern where I often eat, was closing down until January 2nd, refusing to tell a soul what she meant to do with herself. I was out there in the world all by myself and had best find a way to look after me. I switched on the answering machine, grabbed my jacket and handbag, and was just locking up when Darcy Pascoe, the receptionist from the insurance company next door, popped her head in. I had worked for California Fidelity full-time at one point, doing investigations on fire and wrongful death claims. Now the arrangement is informal. I'm more or less on call, doing a certain number of investigations for them as needed, in exchange for downtown office space I couldn't otherwise afford. "Oh, wow, I'm glad I caught you," Darcy said. "Mac told me to give you this." She handed me a file, which I glanced at automatically. The blank form inside indicated that I was being asked to do a fire scene inspection, the first in months. "Mac did," I said. Macklin Voorhees is the California Fidelity vice president. I couldn't imagine him handling routine paperwork. "Well, actually, Mac gave it to Andy, and Andy said I should give it to you," Darcy said. She was referring to Andy Motika, the California Fidelity claims manager. There was a memo attached to the file cover dated 3 days before and marked Rush. Darcy caught my look and her cheeks tinted faintly. "It was stuck under a big pile of stuff on my desk, or I'd have gotten it to you sooner," she said. Darcy's in her late 20s and something of a flake. I crossed to my desk, tossing the file on top of some others I was working on. I'd catch it first thing in the morning. Darcy lingered in the doorway, guessing my intent. "Is there any way you can get to that today? I know he's anxious to get somebody out there."
"What's the claim?"
"A big warehouse fire out in Colgate. You probably heard it on the news."
"I've been down in L.A.
"Well, the newspaper clippings are in there, too. I guess they want someone out there super quick."
I was annoyed at the pressure, but I opened the manila folder again and checked the property loss notice, which was posted on top.
"Wood Warren," I said. "You know the company?"
"I know the Woods. I went to high school with the youngest girl, Ash.
We were in the same homeroom." "Oh, that's great. I'll tell Mac maybe you can get out there this afternoon."
"Darcy, would you knock that off? I've got to take somebody to the airport. Trust me, I'll make an appointment for the earliest possible moment."
"Oh, well, I'll make a note then so they'll know you're taking care of it," she said. "I have to get back to the phones. Let me know when you have the report and I'll come pick it up."
"Terrific," I said. She must have decided she had pushed me far enough because she excused herself and disappeared in haste. As soon as she left, just to get it over with, I put the call through to Wood Warren and arranged to meet with the company president, Lance Wood, at 9 the next morning, Christmas Eve day. I took Henry to the airport and was home again by 6:15, still feeling a bit of a lump in my throat. I hate to say goodbye to folks, and I hate being left behind. It was getting dark by then, and the air had a bite to it. I let myself into my place. My studio apartment was formerly Henry's single-car garage. It's approximately 15 feet on a side, with a narrow extension on the right that serves as my kitchenette. I have laundry facilities and a compact bathroom. The space has been cleverly designed and apportioned to suggest the illusion of living room, dining room, and bedroom once I open my sofa bed. I have more than adequate storage space for the few things I possess. Ever hopeful, I checked my answering machine for messages, but there were none. The quiet was making me feel restless. I turned on the radio. Bing Crosby singing about a white Christmas, just like the ones he used to know. Never actually seen a white Christmas, but I got the gist. I turned the radio off. It was 7 p.m. This was going to be a very long 2 weeks. The next morning, December 24th, I jogged 3 miles, showered, ate, and was heading toward Colgate by 8:45, a quick 10-mile drive. I'd received the Wood Warren file over breakfast, and I was already puzzled about what the big rush was. The newspaper accounts indicated that the warehouse was gutted, but there was no telltale closing line about arson, investigations pending, or any speculation that the nature of the blaze was suspect. The fire department report was included, and I'd read that twice. It all looked routine. Apparently, the origin of the fire was malfunction in the electrical system, which had simultaneously shorted out the sprinklers. Since the materials stored in the two-story structure were largely paper goods, the 2 a.m. fire had spread rapidly. According to the fire inspector at the scene, there was no sign of fire traps, no gasoline or other flammables, and no sign of obstacles placed so as to impede the work of the firemen. There was no indication that doors or windows had been left open to create favorable drafts, and no other physical evidence of incendiary origin. I'd read dozens of reports just like this one, so what was the big deal here, I wondered. Maybe I was missing a crucial piece of information, but as far as I could see, this was a standard claim. I had to guess that somebody at Wood Warren was putting the squeeze on California Fidelity for a speedy settlement, which might explain Andy's panic. He's a nail-biter by inclination, anxious for approval, worried about censure, in the middle of marital problems, from what I'd heard. He was probably the source of the little note of hysteria that had crept into the case. Maybe Mac was leaning on him, too. Colgate is the bedroom community that adjoins Santa Teresa, providing affordable housing for average working folk. Wood Warren was located on a side street that angled back toward an abandoned drive-in theater that functions as a permanent location for weekend swap sales. The lawns of the neighboring manufacturing plant.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.